And what's going on, and I'm just going to give you a bit of background to the reading, otherwise we'll fail to understand the real impact of the conversation that went between her and Elijah. In Tyre, the god of Tyre was this god known as Baal. Now, the god as Baal, there's a couple of Baals, B-A-A-L in the Old Testament, one from Canaan. This is a different false god, Baal. And he was in charge of lightning and of storms, this false Baal. And also he was the god of fertility of the land, so making the land produce. But what had happened, King Ahab, a bad king of ancient Israel, and Jezebel, his wife, they were promoting the worship of this false god in Israel. Now, what do you think God, Yahweh, is going to think about that? Is God going to be happy with that, or is he going to be unhappy?
No.
He's going to be unhappy, right? We all know that. So, God says to Elijah, you go to Ahab, there'll be no rain in Israel for however long, except at my word. In other words, God throws down the gauntlet and he says to Ahab through Elijah, I want a contest with your God. We'll see what real God he is, and I'll show you how I can flex my muscle. So the true God of Israel was Yahweh. Tyre was outside, and the God there was this Baal, who had charge over the lightning and the storms. And his jurisdiction was to make sure the land was fertile. So God says, okay, we'll see who's really God. And all of a sudden, the land begins to dry. There's a famine, there's a drought. Or drought first, and then a famine starts. It lasts actually about 3.5 years. So we're now advanced in this famine. And initially, we're told that God sends Elijah to a brook of Kerith. So it's a creek, basically. He says, I've ordered the ravens to bring you food. Well, Elijah knew where the ravens would hide their food, in the rocks, nuts, and all sorts of things that human beings could also eat. And Elijah will wait till they've placed them there and then go up and get the food that the ravens have. So you take advantage of the ravens' hard work, basically. But that's the advantage of having intelligence rather than just going through instinct. So eventually, though, this creek bed dries up. And then God leads Elijah, now I'm going to lead you to a widow at Zarephath. And this is where we pick up the reading today. So there's a contest going on between the true God of Israel, Yahweh, and the false god, Baal, who's supposed to be in charge of lightning, storms, and the fertility of the land. Clearly, he's not doing his job, right? The false god is failing. Eventually, this leads to the contest that, you know, between Elijah and the false prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. And they have a bull, and he says, right, whichever God responds by fire, so you need lightning basically, is the true God. Okay? But we haven't got there yet. So that's follows. So he meets this woman at the city gate. So it's in Sidon. Reach the city, a widow gathering sticks. Now, a widow, bear in mind, in ancient Israel, noble kings had to protect the rights of the widow and the orphan. Do you think they always did? No. Okay, just like today. The vulnerable don't always get protected. Okay, sadly, but that's the reality. So her husband had died, so she's got no protection. And as we ask to find out, she's got a little child. If the little child were old enough to gather sticks, what do you think she would have done? She would have sent him out to gather the sticks, right? So it must have been a very little boy, and that's it. So and he's too young to be fetching sticks on his own, so she's doing it herself. And then he says, okay, bring me a little water in a vessel for me to drink. So you just imagine dry, dry, dry. And And I've just crossed and camped across two deserts, by the way, recently. I know how dry it is and how wood burns differently in a desert. But you bring me a little water. Okay, come on. You've got to hide. We're in a drought, you know. But anyway, what does she reply? She goes off to fetch it. Please, he said, bring me a scrap of bread in your hand. As the Lord your God lives. Now, somehow, something about Elijah let her know that this guy is an Israelite. Because in the Hebrew, what she refers to is not the Lord God Baal, the false god, but the Lord your God, Yahweh. As he lives, I have no bread. Only a meal, some meal in a jar, a handful. Meal in a jar and a little jar, oil in a jug. The fact that there's no bread, she's using meal to make bread, shows the desperation of the times, and particularly the desperation of this widow. But, so it's very, very advanced in the drought and in the famine. But he says, make a little scone of it for me. And then, okay. So, and then the prophecy comes. Do not be afraid. Do as you have said. First, make a little scone of it for me. For the Lord, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, jar of meal shall not be spent, jug of oil shall not be empty, before the day when the Lord sends rain on the face of the earth. Who knows if this widow has heard about the contest that has gone on now between the God Yahweh, the true God of the universe, and the false god Baal. Perhaps she heard about it, perhaps not. Remember, there's not exactly news coverage like we have in our own days. But the woman goes and believes. She believes this must be a prophet, a holy man. Now, making some bread out of a handful of meal and a bit of oil in a jug, does she just mix it all together, throw in the microwave, 5 minutes and it's done? No. So it's probably going to take an hour or two or so. So wherever she leaves Elijah, she goes there and makes this little bit of bread. Comes back, makes a little scone of it. She would have made enough for her and her son, and then for him. And she brings it back. And now, how much meal is left in the jar, do you think? Probably not much at all. I'd say she would have used it. And the oil as well. Okay, so she bakes it. That day comes. Evening comes, and morning comes, the first day. The next day, she goes and looks at the jar, and the meal in the jar. Oh, there's more there. Wow. Okay, son, we're going to live another day. So, and the same thing happens. And then the next morning, do you think it was always that she went there and found the jars and the jug of meal and the jar of oil that just filled up? I don't think so. Because God, remember, is leading her, just as he's leading Elijah, onto a journey of trust. That's what this is about. I'll look after you, God says to Elijah, but you must be faithful to me. And me looking after you doesn't mean I make things easy for you. But I do look after you. Just like a child, wants all the chocolate bars and jellies and whatever. And mums and dads who are responsible say, no, you're not. But I'll give you bread. Oh, that's not very nice. Yeah, I look after you. Did the woman have to gather sticks and get a fire going and work a bit? Of course she did. But God's looking after her. So in the journey of living in faith and in trust, God's not saying, you just sit back and watch me do it all for you. In the old scriptures, sometimes he does that. Like in the Old Testament there, he parts the sea. And with Moses, and he says, okay, go. Let me, you won't have to do anything. Other battles with Joshua, let the Lord fight the battle for you. But most of the time, being looked after by the Lord means we've got to roll up our sleeves as well. And that's what this woman is doing. But as I meditate on this reading, and I think, okay, the next day, the second day, the jug and the jar are filled up again. But then the third day comes, and she probably went there exactly the same time, expecting them to be filled up. And some days, I imagine, she would have come, and they're still empty. Oh no, what's going on? You see, because if God filled them up like clockwork, then we stop trusting in Him. It's like the paycheck that comes in exactly the same time every fortnight or every month. We just learn to expect it rather than trust that it's going to rock into our account. So I imagine God would have filled the jug and the jar every day, absolutely, but probably at different times in the day, so that this woman and her son would keep trusting that the God of Yahweh, the God of Israel, the God Yahweh rather, the God of Israel, Elijah's God, is able to provide. And remember, this is in Baal's territory. This is happening. So the gods are having a contest amongst themselves. The true God is so powerful, Yahweh, that He's even in the enemy God, the competitor God, He's even able to control His own territory as well, which of course is what shows that Yahweh is the true God. For us, a lesson we can draw from this reading is, how do we walk in trust? God puts us to the test sometimes, doesn't He? Yet, some of you will have had financial difficulties, some of you have had health difficulties, some of you have had relationship troubles, broken marriages, whatever. But, not whatever, because I know you, but we carry these things, and in them, God invites us to trust, to walk with me, that He will give us each day our daily bread. But we also, with our Lord's words, we say to Him, do not put us to the test. That's what we mean when we say, lead us not into temptation. Because the Greek word means to tempt, to test, or to attempt. In that sense, our Lord uses it in the Our Father, do not put us to the test. Why wouldn't you want to be put to the test? It's a chance when you have an exam to show off what you know. But we don't like being put to the test because we may just fail the test. So that's what we say to God, don't put me to the test too much. I know you've got to test me in order to help me grow in virtue, but don't put me to the test too much because I'm weak, I'm vulnerable, and I fall enough times and I might just fall again. But the Lord will only make our virtue grow, or can only make our virtue grow, if He tests us. Now, I know when I first came to this parish, we were $70,000 in the red. This is a standard preoccupation for parish priests and administrators. $70,000 in the red. And the parish had been that way for 10 years. Yeah, no, money was being wasted, right? For those of us watching on camera, money was being spent on legitimate things, updating the parish, whatever, the properties that we had and so forth. But I thought, how on earth would this happen? $70,000 in the red. So $70,000 more spent every year than what we actually had in the parish coming in. So I thought, this has got to stop. But naturally, I'm getting concerned, how can we keep the parish afloat? Little by little, things started to return closer to the black. And in the last 3-4 years, the auditors have told us, we are actually now in the black. Now that doesn't mean what comes in through the second collection is actually sufficient to keep us afloat, no. But we're managing. And my aim and hope is that eventually what comes in through our second collections and what comes in through our first collections to maintain the priest will be enough to make us truly independent and able to sufficiently look after ourselves. How do you think money is coming in? Of course, you're being generous, and other benefactors are generous. But God is opening hearts. God walks with us and leads us in a journey of faith and trust. And through this, we begin to see his glory, little by little. Just as the woman and eventually her son, he would have said to her, "Mummy, is there any we're going to have bread today? I don't know, son, but we'll see. We'll see. The God Yahweh, the God of Israel, has been looking after us now for all this time. I'm sure he'll provide again." So let's pray and trust. We're not being so much being tested because of food and drink, but we are tested in other ways. And the Lord wants us to place our total trust in a real abandonment in his love for us. And that's what ought to be our greatest motivation. So let's pause and pray. Heavenly Father, just as you provided for Elijah and for this widow of Zarephath and her son, we ask that you continue to provide for us our own daily bread. Grant us to trust in you and to not be convinced so much by what we see with our eyes, but rather to trust unshakably in your promise to us that you will look after us through thick and thin, even though you will test us and at times you will permit us to taste the bitterness of the cross. Amen.